Thank you for joining us at First Baptist Church of Yazoo City. Whether you're watching live or delayed taping, I pray that as you participate in our service, that God speaks to you and works in your life today. Should you need spiritual guidance, please call 888-JESUS-20. Thanks again for joining us and have a great day.
Stand up and join with us as we sing. Sorry about that. All right, let's sing this morning, Worthy of Worship.
Father,
Well, it's good to see you today. I appreciate you for being here. And I pray that as we come, that we do indeed come here with a heart that's set on worshiping the Lord, for there is indeed none like Him. As we think back upon His acts of mercy in our lives and how He has blessed us, and He's brought us to this place today, He's given us the ability to be here. Most importantly, He's given us the desire to be here because of what He has done in our lives. And so let's gather together to worship Him today. As we continue in that, let's pray together and let's prepare our hearts for what God wants to do today. Holy God, thank You for the honor it is to come into Your house, for You have given us a promise that You meet with us as we gather in Your name. Just ask that as we come, Lord, that we do make this time about You, for You alone are worthy of our worship. God, still our hearts before You. Help us just to lay aside the concerns, obligations that we have, the many things competing for our attention, and help us to focus on the cross. As we sing about the cross and Your blood in these next songs, may we just be moved by Your mercy to allow Your Holy Spirit to reign during this time, and may Your will be done in our lives. Forgive us for our many failures, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
All right, if you would stand with us again as we continue to give praise to the Lord through song. There's power in the blood.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir, for that reminder about mercy, how mercy sees us. If you'll join me this morning in Matthew chapter 7, I found that we are very thankful for the mercy of God upon our lives, but we don't like to give that mercy out in the same way. We're thankful for His grace, mercy, Him withholding the things that we deserve, grace, Him giving the things that we do not deserve. We're not as free with those things as the Lord is. Yet His Word tells us that we've been impacted by His mercy and His grace, that we are to be merciful and graceful people. Let's notice what Jesus says about that as He's on the Sermon on the Mount. He begins Matthew 7 and verse 1 says, "Do not be judged, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." Story is told of a young man, a young bachelor, who couldn't find a wife. For every lady that he dated and brought home to his mother hated. She basically treated that young lady to the point that she didn't want to be around her boyfriend, this woman's son, any longer. He thought he would never get married, and finally one day he was talking to a friend about this, and a friend says, "Listen, what you need to do is you need to choose a girl that's just like your mom." He thought, "Well, you know what, I love my mom, that'll be okay." So he found somebody who looked like his mom, talked like his mom, walked like his mom, even acted like his mom. He took her home, mom loved him, or loved her. A few weeks later, he came across that same friend. "How are things going with you and the missus? How'd my advice go?" So it went great. "My mom loves her, but my dad can't stand her." A critical spirit, a condemning attitude, is a disease of the human life. It's all around us, and it is unpleasant. Few things are more exhausting and more debilitating than harsh, unloving criticism. Even sadder, the church itself is full of those who make a habit of criticism and condemnation. There are some, I believe, who even think that being critical is their spiritual gift. That's one extreme. The other extreme is for those who say you should never make a judgment. You may have seen this picture floating around the internet. This is how today's world would like for you to view this passage. Judge not. And then forget the rest of what Jesus is talking about. Because they love to tell us, "You can't judge me." But we'll see in a minute, Jesus calls us to make judgments. Scripture is full with commands to do so. The text can never say what the text never said. And so we can't look at this and just say that it means that we cannot judge or we should not judge. That is the those are the two extremes of what Jesus is talking about. Two extremes here of a critical, judgmental spirit. It's those who everything is wrong to those that everything is okay. The world is guilty of taking a verse and using it to prove what you already believe. And I think that's how this verse has been used. It's been used to convey the idea, you live your lifestyle and I'll live mine. You don't tell me how I live and I won't tell you how you live. You don't try to impose your standards of morality on me. Judge not. It's spouted by a lot of people who have no earthly idea about what Jesus meant. And I venture to say that the people who quote this verse the most are the ones who understand it the least. It just happens to fall into the spirit of our time. This passage, remember, Jesus is on the Sermon on the Mount, his first sermon that he gives we have recorded. Those listening would have been the crowd, but also part of that crowd would have been the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, the scribes were there. And Jesus has called them already, called the people listening, to have a righteousness that surpasses that of the scribes and the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. Because the scribes and the Pharisees, they were the critics of the day. They looked at you and determined whether or not
you were doing correctly. And it was all on the outside. And Jesus, as you know in the Sermon on the Mount, is teaching that the Lord is concerned with what's on the inside, with our motivations for the reason why we do what we do, for the motives that we have in life, that those are the things that he is addressing, because what's inside eventually flows outside. So, what is Jesus telling us here? What does this mean to us to have a righteousness that surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, that we must be concerned about what's inside? We must be concerned about our motives, the motivations, and why we do what we do. This passage teaches us how to relate to others. To judge or not to judge is the question for us to look at this morning. How should we relate? Well, first off, we see in this passage that we should relate without condemning judgment. Again, this verse 1 has been called the backslider's favorite verse. It's quoted by more non-Christians probably than anyone else. Don't judge me. Do not judge has been misunderstood and taken by some to mean that faithful Christians can never exercise any critical judgment. Some people have bought into the lie that Christians are to be totally accepting whatever the situation, let's just welcome it all in. You know, it's ironic to me that our world loves opinionated people until it comes to conventional morality. In these matters, the world adores the non-judgmental person. But the reason that this text cannot be made to say that we're never to judge are obvious to me. Notice verse 6, the next verse, Jesus tells them, do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces. We cannot know, we cannot obey this passage unless we understand who the dogs and who the pigs are. And to know that, you must make judgment. He goes on in verse 15 of chapter 7, watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. This requires subtle, discriminating judgment on our part. We cannot obey that verse without making judgments. That same spirit continues. John writes in 1 John chapter 4, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. John had written earlier in his gospel in John 7, stop judging by mere appearances and make a right judgment. Scripture is full with commands that you and I must make judgments in our life. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11, not to associate with someone who claims to be a brother who is, quote, sexually immoral, greedy, an idolater, a slanderer, a drunkard, or a swindler. Not to associate with him. So a judgment has to be made. How do we reconcile Jesus' words, do not judge, with what the rest of Scripture tells us? As believers, we have an obligation to exercise judgment. And we have seen judgment. Maybe we have a poor idea. Maybe we think of a judgment as something that a judge does, and he's got the gavel, and he hits the gavel down, and he tells a punishment that has to be served as a result of a crime. And maybe we have a poor perspective of judgment. Maybe a better word, maybe one we understand more, would be discernment. The Lord calls us to be discerning. There is a universe of difference between being critical and being discerning. A discerning spirit is constructive. He gives warning. It tries to prepare people. It tries to save people from danger that may be down the road. But a critical spirit is destructive. The person with a destructive, critical spirit enjoys his position, and he expects to find fault. He's like the guy who lived next door to a preacher. He saw the preacher one day building a playhouse for his children, and he just went and sat down in the yard watching the preacher. The preacher thought, well, this guy might need some construction tips, and the preacher was well-versed in construction, so he just carried along. You know, the guy never left. And so finally he looked up, and he said, is there something I can show you specifically? I guess you're here needing some help, needing some tips. And the guy looked up and said, no, I don't need anything. I just want to see what a preacher says when he hits his thumb with a hammer. How often is that us? We sit back and we wait to see someone fail. Because when a critic finds fault in another, he is satisfied. It's almost like he can pat himself on the back. Look what I've done. I found what someone did. Jesus taught that when we see a brother in sin, we're to warn them. A brother sins against us, Jesus said, you go to them. You don't go to anybody else. You don't call anybody else. You don't take any other motives or any other actions. Your motives are to restore the relationship that's been hindered, and you go to the one who has offended you. Other than the Great Commission, that is probably the most disobeyed scripture in the church today. Because we love to tell somebody else what someone did to us. And when you accept that, you are sinning just as the person who is telling you that. Because what you ought to do is say, stick up your hand or whatever that tells them to be quiet. You don't want to hear it. And they need to go to the person that offended them. But a critical person, a judgmental person, comes and they're telling what somebody else did. And if we had that same spirit, we want to know the details. Oh, when did that happen? How'd that come about? Why would they ever do such a thing? What were they thinking? You need to get even with them. What are you going to do? What's your response going to be? And we pour fuel on the fire. Often, the critical, fault-finding person focuses on things that are of little importance. And they treat them as matters of vital importance. The way you act, the version of the Bible that you read has split many churches. Some very minute areas of theological differences have hurt many people through the years. Things that are not important, but we treat as if they're important. And the pettiness on secondary issues is condemned in Romans chapter 14 in the strongest of terms. Paul says, accept the one whose faith is weak without quarreling over disputable matters. Then he goes in where he's talking about there was a complaint in the church at Rome about who was eating what. And then he says, who are you to judge someone else's servant? To their own master, servants stand or fall, and they will stand, for the Lord is able to make them stand. And in the strongest words in Romans chapter 2, verse 1, Paul says, you therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge one another, you are condemning yourself because you pass judgment to do the same things. See, we set the standard and the tone for our final judgment by our judgmental conduct in life. And we prove by our judging of others that we know what is right. So if we don't do what is right, then we condemn others. Because when we judge, we say we accept what's right and we know what's right. Then if we don't match up to it, we have judged and condemned ourselves. If we set ourselves up as authorities and judges over others, we should not be surprised, nor should we complain when we are judged by our own standard. Jesus says in verse 2, for in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And the measure you use, it will be measured to you. We need to face and apply this text with all of its fearful force. How will this affect us eternally? Well, there are two eternal judgments. One is the separation of the believers and the non-believers, the sheep and the goats. The sheep are those who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ. At that moment, they experience heaven. The goats are those who have not, and they spend eternity in hell. The sheep, the believers, go to be with God, where they will then appear before the judgment seat of Christ to receive their proper rewards. There, God will judge us as we have judged others. Judgmental believers, yes, will go there to live and to be with God forever, but they will have very little reward, for their critical spirit will have erased much of the good they have done in their lives. Very few of us probably are dare or brave enough to pray the prayer, Lord, judge me as I judge others. That is how God will judge us, though. He will judge us as we judge others. The tone of your life is going to become the tone of your judgment. And friends, that ought to scare us to death. Because for too long, we have been good at pointing out someone else's sin, ignoring the sin that's in our life. There is nothing more ungodly, I believe, than a critical spirit, and nothing more unchristlike than the false righteousness that's always looking for something wrong in someone else. taking petty things that mean absolutely nothing. There's another thing we see here, and that we are to relate to other without critical comparisons. So we don't condemn them in judgment, but also we need to make sure that we are not comparing ourselves. The picture Jesus gives here is ludicrous. It is sarcastic. We have become so familiar with it that we really have lost that as we read it. But he talks about, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? The word translated plank or log there denotes a huge piece of wood. Basically, it would be a rafter in a house. The speck or sawdust is something very small. With such a huge log in his eye, a man's vision would not simply be impaired. He would be absolutely blind. The idea of him lending a helping hand to another man who has a speck in his eye would not only be comical, but it would be impossible. Imagine that you've got something protruding from your eye. You've got a rafter from your eye. You can't get close to the guy who has a speck. For when you get close to him and you try to examine him, your rafter is going to hit him upside the head, and you're never going to be able to see what is in his eye. The tragedy is that the scenario that Jesus is portraying is common. He was looking at those Pharisees. They were so worried about the speck, the sawdust in someone's eye, and yet they had the rafter, the log sticking out of theirs. And they're trying to examine those that are around them. And friends, we must be careful as believers in Jesus Christ that we don't become so pharisaical that we have the huge log in our eye and we are so concerned about the speck of sawdust in someone else. And when we have that, not only are we passing condemning judgment, but we are giving critical comparisons. And we stand the same way before the Lord. When King David was at lowest point of lowest morality in his life, probably one of the lowest points in his life, he'd taken Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, committed adultery with her, then had Uriah murdered to try to cover up what had taken place. After this time, Nathan the prophet came to David. He told David the story about a rich man who had a whole bunch of lambs. He had a guest coming over. And rather than sacrificing, killing one of his own lambs and preparing it, he stole one from a poor man who only had one little ewe lamb that he treated like a daughter, like a child. David becomes outraged. That man must die, for he saw what had happened there. He must repay everything fourfold. Nathan pointed a prophetic finger at the king and pronounced, David, you are that man. Basically, he says, David, forget about the speck in someone else's eye, and you look at the log in your own eye. We find it so easy to turn a microscope onto someone else's sin while we look at ours through the wrong end of a telescope. We use some strong term for someone else's sin, but we excuse our own. It's not gossip, it's just passing on information. It's not lust, it's just looking. It's not unfaithfulness, it's just fun. It's not lying, it's just stretching the truth. But let that happen in somebody else's life, and we make a critical comparison. We easily spot a speck of phoniness in someone else because we have a logjam of it in our own lives. And Jesus says that log-toting speck inspectors are hypocrites. We love that word. The unchurched really loves it. Preacher, I ain't coming to that church up there. You've got nothing but a bunch of hypocrites. You know what my response usually is to them? One more is not going to make a difference. Come and join us. Because of the way the world uses that passage, that word hypocrites, we're all hypocrites. Because we sin repeatedly, and we call people not to sin, and we know what God's Word says, we hold it up, we elevate it, we know God's standard, and yet we hold that up and we continue to sin. We're hypocrites by that standard. But Jesus' standard of a hypocrite, it's different. Because a hypocrite really doesn't care about the speck in their own, in somebody else's eye. All a hypocrite really cares is about building themselves up in their own eyes. And so as long as we call sin what it is, and we're working on that in our lives, we are not hypocrites. We become hypocrites when we ignore the sin that's there and try to elevate ourselves to being somebody that we're not. And that's what the Pharisees had done. Critical comparisons. Why do we criticize? Why do we find ourselves in this trap? I mean, there's a lot of reasons. I mean, criticism boosts our own self-image. As we point out somebody else's faults, that makes us look a whole lot better, doesn't it? You can always find somebody that's worse off than you are. Criticism is an enjoyed pastime. There's a tendency in human nature to take pleasure in hearing and sharing bad news and shortcomings. Because all we hear it, we got to pass it on. Do you hear what so-and-so did? Did you hear what happened over there? Criticism makes us feel that our own lives are better than the person who failed. That our morality and our behavior is better. Many times it helps us justify the decisions we've made and the things we've done throughout our lives. We rationalize our actions by pointing out the failure of others. Many times criticism points out how strong we are, supposedly, to our friends. We can criticize because we know what's right. Many times it gives us good feelings because our rigid beliefs and our strong lives are proven again and again as we compare ourselves to those who have failed. It's another outlet for revenge and hurt. Many times we feel they deserve it. He hurt me, so I hurt him. And we criticize the person who failed. We tell you, it's easy to compare ourselves to others. For in our eyes, again, we can always find somebody that we think is worse off than we are. But that leads to a false security. There is nothing more unchristlike than a false righteousness that's always looking for something wrong in someone else. So we must remove the critical comparisons in our life. So how do we relate to others? I mean, you think about these first two things and how tough they are in our life to remove. How do we deal with somebody? Simple. We deal with them. We relate to them as brothers and sisters. We are to judge ourselves. Is where we begin. Take the plank out of your own eye, Jesus says. And when we do this, we begin to see others as they are. From your brother's eye. Your brother. See, we begin to see others as we are, then we see them as they are. Instead of being critical, we weep for ourselves and for them. Instead of pointing a finger, our heart breaks over our sin and their sin. When we have removed the log from our own eyes, then we can see clearly to take the speck from our brother and our sister's eyes. And that's our responsibility. Now, Jesus doesn't encourage an attitude of not caring here. He wants us to discern the sins and the shortcomings of others, but He wants us to see them through clear, self-judged eyes, eyes then that are tender and compassionate, eyes that then break for the speck that we see in the lives of others, because we know if that speck's not dealt with, it will eventually become a log. The procedure for removing a speck from an eye is very difficult. It's delicate. There's nothing more sensitive in the human body than the eye. We don't try it now, but try poking yourself in the eye later. You're not going to be able to do it. You're going to close your eye before you get there. Ask anybody who's ever put in contacts how hard it is to begin with to keep your eye open as you watch your finger go in your eye. The instant we get close, it just closes up. So if you get something in your eye, what's required is gentleness and carefulness and patience, sympathy for the other person. And in the spiritual realm, the care is even more delicate, for we are handling a soul, the most sensitive part of a human being. So we must be humble and sympathetic. must be conscious of our own sins, and we must approach them without condemnation. We need God's mercy. We need to be people who speak the truth in love, because the love of God controls us. And we remove all condemnation and all critical comparisons out of our life. And we see each other as brothers and sisters. And with that, we're moved to compassion, and we're moved by love to remove the things out of our life and then to assist others in getting it out of their lives. As of today, unemployed for my second job. I've termed as softball coach is over. I'll sign up for unemployment tomorrow. But a couple weeks ago, we were playing, and Mr. Hart, our little girls, we hadn't won a game. And it was hot, and it was getting long, and we wanted to win. So we're playing a team that I look and I tell Michael, hey, I think we can beat this team. And sure enough, we start off and we're winning, and it was enjoyable. More so for us than the girls, probably. Anyway, this little team we're playing, they've made all kinds of mistakes, and I was feeling sorry for them. I know what it's like to be there. Our girls, when that happened, they got mad at themselves, and they pouted, and they shut down. But I watched this little shortstop on the other team turn around. She hollered, "Come on, girls, we can do this. I believe in you." She said it about two other times throughout the game. When it was over and we won and we shook hands and we prayed there at the end, I looked at the coach, who I didn't know at the time was her daddy. I said, "Coach, where's your shortstop?" And he said, "Well, she's right here." And so I tell the little girls, "Listen, I heard you say this to your team. And I'm going to tell you something. I don't care how bad you get beat out here. In my eyes, you're a winner." And that daddy got tears in his eyes. And I've thought about that little girl for about the last 3 weeks. Because in my mind, she's a great picture of what the church ought to be. Amen. That we say, "Hey, listen, I know you failed. And I know it hurts and you've got the scars. But listen, the grace of God is greater than that. I believe in that. And I believe in you, and you can change your life. Will you let me help you?" See, I've got my own failures. I've been there and I've done that. I know what it's like to make that mistake. But you can do this through the grace of God. Would you let me help you? That's what Jesus is talking about in this passage. That a righteousness that surpasses that of what looks on the outside. And we're concerned about the inside. And we remove all condemnation and all critical comparisons in our life. And we focus on each other as brothers and sisters. And to you, some of you, that may be a skewed concept, because there may be nothing but hate in your family. And you may look and go, "Well, there's not a love between my brother and my sisters." That's not how God created it. That's not how God intended. He expected within his family, and especially within the family of God, that there would be love between one another. "For this all men will know," Jesus said, "you are my disciples, if you love one another. Not if you stand on the street corner and proclaim it, not if you go to church, not if you do anything else, but if you love one another." And that love is what is needed in our world today, because it's the love of Christ shown to those that are around us. Let's face it, we're going to leave here, and we're going to be angry over something we see. Someone's going to disappoint us. Someone close to us, maybe something you see in the newspaper, maybe you see some agenda that's pushing our world today. Maybe remember Ruth Graham driving through road construction one time, and when she got to the end of it, there was a sign that said, "End of construction, thanks for your patience." And she looked at Billy and said, "I want that on my tombstone. End of construction, thanks for your patience." Friends, until we get to heaven, God is still working on us. And we used to sing that little song, "He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be." It took him just a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth, and Jupiter and Mars. How loving and patient he must be, for he's still working on me. God's working on me. God's still working on you. God's still working in the world. We need to be patient. And know that when He returns or He calls us home, the construction, the work is complete. And until then, we're going to fail. There's things that are going to drive us crazy. And we must make judgments. We must be discerning. But we do it without condemnation and without any critical spirit in our lives. These critical spirits are all around us. But friends, they should not be in the church. They should not be in the child of God. So may God purge it from our lives. And maybe we have those things in our lives because we've never experienced the grace and the mercy of the Lord ourselves. See, if you're here today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus, you don't know about the mercy that the choir sang about earlier. You've never experienced that. For you deserve hell, and without a relationship with Jesus, that's where you're going. But mercy, He will withhold His wrath from us as we place our faith in His Son and His work on the cross in an empty tomb. And we get to experience that love. Believer, do we forget about that? Have you forgotten the price of your sins? Have you forgotten that you stood condemned before God? And maybe today we need, in view of His mercy, to offer ourselves to Him. Ask Him to forgive us of a critical spirit. We may need to ask for forgiveness for the way we've judged others. But also maybe you've taken this verse, as many have, and said, do not judge, and you've made no judgments at all. And God's calling you to step up in your life and call sin what it is, that it's sin. It hinders your relationship with Him. Let us begin to remove logs from our eyes and specks from our eyes so that we can stand holy before a holy God. John chapter 8, Jesus is confronted by a mob pushing forward a woman that was caught in the act of adultery. The mob tried to use her to trap Jesus, as they often did. The Jewish law said this woman must die. There was no debate about it. Roman law said she couldn't be killed without their permission. There was never any doubt about the woman's guilt. There was never any doubt about the seriousness of her action. Nobody there tried to diminish what she did. So what did Jesus do when He was confronted by the sinner? First, He refused to look down on her. He didn't allow the mob to treat her like a thing. Rather, He forced them to consider their own sin. But second, He didn't justify her behavior. He wouldn't refer to her actions as anything other than sin. He forgave her, and He challenged her to stop sinning. And that's how He looks at us today, that the world is ready to throw stones. And Jesus looks at us as one created in the image of His Father, one that He died for. And the call is still the same. Go and sin no more. Let's remove the logs and the specks from our eyes. Would you bow with me? Holy God, as we bow before You, we declare our need for You. Lord, You are the righteous judge. And so often, Father, we set ourselves up as an unrighteous judge. Lord, today You call us to make judgment, so may we call sin what it is in our lives, first of all. May we continue to stand upon Your word for what sin is and boldly declare that in our world. But Lord, let us do it with love. Lord, I just pray that as we bow here, that You are pleased with the response to Your word that's about to take place. We stand condemned, Lord, apart from Your Son. May those who have never placed their trust in Him, may they do that at this time by being obedient to Your call. Lord, others have forgotten the cross. They've forgotten mercy. We've made big things out of small things. Lord, today, let Your mercy, Your grace, Your forgiveness reign in this place. change our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand together? As we stand, as we sing, I have decided to follow Jesus. If you have a public decision to make, would you come quickly this morning? Maybe you need to come to this altar. Most importantly, may you be obedient to God's call. Bow with me. Would you just spend this time between you and the Lord? Have you followed Him, first of all? And have you turned back? It's a lonely road. Nobody may go with you except for the Lord. And as we base our life upon Him, His Word, we're never alone. If you turn back, Christian, you need to just turn around. Come home today.
Decision. The altar is still open. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today that has brought us life and freedom from sin. Father, today we ask you to bless this offering, use it to the furtherance of thy kingdom. Lord, thank you for providing jobs and goodness, and Lord, thank you for your many, many blessings. Lord, thank you for this day. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Still and know that He is God.
still and know that He is faithful. Consider all that He has done. Stand in awe and be amazed. Know that He will never change. Be still. Be
with us, and let's sing our closing song this morning, the family prayer song.
As for me and my house, we will serve.